The Alien universe has so much lore around it. A lot of fans are familiar with what is displayed on film, but there is so much more to go over. From sources like novels, comic books, and video games, we can dig deeper into different ideas that writers had in mind. This video will include various topics I covered in the past. It's going to be another 1-hour compilation video. So if you missed out on these older videos, this will be a fresh introduction to possibly new lore you are unaware of. But if these are topics you have seen before, we can still discuss the ideas in these stories. And as usual, I will leave timestamps before we start and also within the video description and comment section. So sit back and enjoy. The Alien Xenomorph Homeworld. Although it's never been seen in the movies, we do have some information about it coming from other sources. Now, Xenomorph Prime is also known as the Hive World, or A6454 by some scientists. Now, it is the homeworld of the Xenomorph XX121 species, along with several other species. Now, it's noted that the size of the planet is equivalent to the size of our Earth and has 3 major continents and a small ocean. This planet is expected to be full of xenomorphs, and most of the landscape is covered in an enormous hive. But you'll also find deserts, mountains, oceans, and some other landscape features that are not covered with hive material. Now, there's speculation that there are probably multiple xenomorph hives that support each other in order to keep this planet under their control. Now, the climate here is cold and harsh with volcanoes and turbulent windstorms. Millions of years ago, this planet was used as a storage house by the space jockey race to contain and breed xenomorphs that were used in their war. Now, in the 2010 video game Aliens vs. Predator, during the Predator's ending sequence, we can see Dark Predator and his clan are now heading towards the xenomorph homeworld. Now, this is also seen in the Marines ending, where the Weyland-Yutani Corporation discovers the coordinates to the xenomorph homeworld and also travels there.
This has been a high-cost operation. Let us hope my predecessor's faith in it was justified. It's everything we'd hoped. Worth waiting centuries for. The coordinates to the Xenomorph homeworld.
Although this planet is mostly populated by the Xenomorph, there are still other types of species that are just as dangerous. For example, we have the unnamed Xenomorph predators, which look like pale lizards. They were the natural enemies of the xenomorph on this planet. This creature was not at the top of the food chain, but was merely keeping the population balanced between their species and the xenomorphs. Now, they were able to compete in combat with the xenomorphs because of their ability to not be affected by the xenomorphs' acid blood effects. This planet also contains the rare red xenomorphs who frequently fight back with their black-colored rivals. Now, although this planet was never seen in a film, director Ridley Scott once considered to explore this planet in the 2013 film Prometheus, but it was cut from the final product. Other types of xenomorphs on this planet include facehuggers, royal facehuggers, chestbursters, praetorians, queens, empress, queen mother, and palatines. Now, aliens ranging from facehuggers to even queens have been kidnapped and taken off this world by the Yautja to begin a hunt on other worlds like Earth. So, what are your thoughts about the Xenomorph homeworld? Would you like to see it explored in a future film or video game? What happened after the Prometheus movie when Elizabeth Shaw left the moon, LV-223? Well, in the comic book, Prometheus, Fire and Stone, a story was explained. Now, the story starts off in the year 2090, which is about 1 year after the events of the Prometheus movie. A probe is sent to the moon, LV-223, and as it landed, it scans the area, only to get crushed by an engineer's foot. This gives us a clue that there is still at least one other engineer on this moon. Then they fast forward the story's timeline to the year 2219, which is more than 120 years after the events of Prometheus, a crew on board the spacecraft called Geryon is believed to be on a routine salvage mission. A crew member named Clara starts recording a documentary about her mission by using a pup device similar to the ones we saw in the Prometheus movie. As the team arrives on the moon, they come across a lush jungle filled with strange alien life forms. This is different from what the Prometheus crew experienced over 120 years ago when it was a barren, empty environment. As the group ventures forward, they come across a field of dead creatures and a lake of black goo. Francis takes a sample of the goo to study it later on. Then they come across an alien ship and unwillingly open the doors to unleash xenomorphs that kill some of the crew. The survivors try to make their way across a lake, and some members of the team fall into the water with mutated sharks waiting down below. These mutated creatures seem to have some features that resemble the Deacon alien from the Prometheus movie. This team then continues on to find a derelict spacecraft where an alien-like weapon is found. Meanwhile, in a cave located away from this incident, Francis and Eldon study some research left behind by a previous person. Francis assumes that the black goo is what formed the jungle. By his predictions, he assumes the black goo can cure diseases like cancer due to its genetic mutation process. Francis injects Eldon with the black goo and has some unexpected results. Eldon gets a burning sensation. His flesh starts to melt off and he mutates. Francis fears for his life and abandons his longtime friend and tries to run away, only to be caught up by Eldon later on. Then Francis runs back to his ship. He meets up with his crew members to find the ship surrounded by xenomorphs. As Eldon emerges, he is ignored by the alien xenomorphs and opens the ship doors to allow the aliens inside to wreak even more havoc on any survivors. Now at this point, some crew members return to the derelict spacecraft, and deep within, they find a laboratory that was used to create other life forms. Clara remains in this area to document all of it, and is later joined by Weddle. The two of them are surrounded by aliens, and then an unexpected engineer shows up to save them. Then, as the two express their gratitude for being saved, the engineer vaporizes them with the same weapon. At this point, Eldon is inside the Helios ship, and along with some aliens, he takes control of the ship and sets off to find Francis. Now back on the moon, only Angel, Chris, and Jill are the remaining survivors of this encounter. They make their way back to a cave and are left stranded unless help arrives. So the story then gets continued in the Fire and Stone issues, and along with the Life and Death issues. They expanded on the story by including more engineers, the black goo, aliens, predators, and they even bring up the maps that were seen in other caves during the Prometheus movie. Now, what I liked about the story is that it showed us that something else happened on a moon that we presumed had no other life forms. But at the same time, it did not give us an explanation of what happened to Shaw. I'm also curious if the Deacon alien was still alive during this time period. So what do you guys think about this story? Put your thoughts in the comments section. If you enjoyed this video, then subscribe to see more content around the Alien and Predator universe. Thanks for watching. My name is Asaglow, and I'll see you in the next video. Hey guys, Asaglow here with another video around the Alien universe. This time we're looking at the crocodile alien that was featured in the comic book Batman Aliens. So the story takes place in a jungle near the Guatemala and Mexico border. Batman goes here looking for a geologist working for Wayne Enterprises. He parachutes in and meets a female operative named Hayat. Batman is then attacked by a crocodile, but is able to wrestle it and ties its mouth shut. As the story progresses, Batman meets up with a special forces unit that's tracking a target. They all work together for now, and then stumble upon an alien ship with alien facehuggers and some dead hosts. Now by the end of the first issue, the crocodile that attacked Batman earlier finds an egg and then gets facehugged. Now at this point, Batman is set up by Hayat. He is held hostage by her until she is caught off guard by the massive crocodile alien and gets killed instantly. Batman then has to fight this gigantic beast alone. With the use of some bladed weapons, Batman quickly learns of the alien's acidic blood. It strikes the creature a few more times to make it bleed. The alien blood then melts the floor enough for it to shatter, and the beast falls into a pool of molten lava. Batman manages to make it out alive and even takes a facehugger specimen to study it more. Now there was another time a similar type of xenomorph was seen. In another comic book called Batman Aliens 2, This creature was genetically created by combining the DNA of a xenomorph and the villain known as Killer Croc. Batman does battle the creature, but it doesn't last very long. As the facility is burning, Batman jumps through a hole, trying to land in the water. He releases his cape as the creature follows from behind. The cape lands on its face, and the ceiling collapses and the fire engulfs it. Now, this is one of those really scary creatures just by its sheer size and strength. It's quite amazing seeing the size and special traits these aliens get from their hosts. Now, one was created naturally with a facehugger, while the other one was created through DNA manipulation. And looking back at it now, I don't think I've seen many alien types from an animal host that were this huge. But what do you think about the crocodile alien, and which version do you think looks better? Put your thoughts in the comment section. If you enjoyed this video, then subscribe for more content surrounding the Alien and Predator universe. Thanks for watching. My name is Asaglow, and I'll see you in the next video. Welcome back everyone, Asaglow here, back with another video around the Alien universe. So in this video I'll be explaining the story in Batman Aliens 2, which is a second comic book in the crossover. So the story takes place in the present time. A construction site uncovers an underground chamber that is sealed off. Deep inside is a laboratory full of research on the xenomorph species. The crew who explores this area are then cocooned by a xenomorph from inside, and then it escapes. This xenomorph appears to be white-colored, which is different from the rest we've seen. After the alien escapes, Batman comes in to investigate and takes a book that talks about the alien's life cycle process. Batman recognizes the species, as he fought them before during a trip to a jungle a few years ago. Meanwhile, the people who were cocooned by the alien are then impregnated by facehuggers. Batman later finds out this person brought back an alien, and the laboratory they uncovered was his research lab. This person originally found the aliens in a cave located in Antarctica in the year 1928. Batman takes off to track the alien and battles it in a subway. Now along the way, he discovers bodies with facehuggers attached to them. After the alien escapes again, these bodies are taken immediately for surgery to remove the chestbursters. So then Dr. Catherine Fortune, who is with the Federal Emergency Medical Authority, comes in and shows a lot of interest in the chestbursters that have been taken from the victims through surgery. Now, before the alien specimens can be taken away, the alien drops in from the ceiling to reclaim the chestburster, and Batman fights the alien again, but it eventually escapes. Now back at home, Batman takes some time to rest, and he gets a nightmare of seeing his friends and himself impregnated by facehuggers. The nightmare ends when he sees himself die from a chestburster. By now, the previous chestbursters have matured into fully grown warrior aliens, and are all headed to what looks like a prison where some villains are locked up. Batman was able to tag the first alien with radium gel, so it's able to track its movements. With a brand new suit, he heads to the new location of the aliens. A battle ensues here with some aliens, and then Batman discovers that Dr. Catherine Fortune is able to control the aliens. She knocks Batman away, but we also catch a glimpse of what looks like Killer Croc's body being used for experiments. Batman is captured, then he wakes up on a drilling rig in the ocean somewhere. He's then forced to fight against a group of alien-human hybrids created through genetic manipulation. It turns out Dr. Catherine took DNA samples from the Joker, Harvey Dent, Pamela Isley, Jonathan Crane, and Victor Fries to create these hybrids that are still able to take orders. Now during this battle, many explosions occur, and Batman eventually defeats them all. He later finds a laboratory full of alien-human hybrids that are incomplete. At this point, Catherine finds Batman and explains her sole reason for creating these creatures is to counter any hero that might turn into a bad guy in the future. She later explains she was part of the expedition that occurred in 1928, and she also had an alien inside her, but the chestburster never fully matured and remained inside her, all due to a case of dry leprosy she contracted on an early expedition. Now with the alien being part of her body, it gave her increased strength and agility, and it prolonged her life. At this point, her troops try to shoot Batman, but instead, they end up releasing one more creature by mistake, the alien Killer Croc hybrid. Now Batman defeats this creature very quickly, and the story ends as the rig blows up, along with all the hybrids left inside. Now what I liked about this comic book was that the art style was really well done. The story dragged on for a long time, which I did enjoy, and Batman had a lot of encounters with the alien. It actually turned out to be a really good story when it mainly focused on the alien that was running loose in the city. But when we got to the part about the alien-human hybrids near the end, I was really surprised to see them, even though they didn't last that long in the story. So what did you think about the story overall? Did you like the idea of the alien-human hybrids? Put your thoughts in the comment section. What's up everyone, Acidglow here. So I'm back with another video covering the Alien universe. So this time I'll be talking about the Alien King, also known as the Rogue Xenomorph. Now it was featured in the comic books called Alien Rogue. So the Alien King was a human Xenomorph hybrid, genetically engineered by Professor Ernst Kleist. The Alien King was part of Project Chimera, which was meant to splice the Xenomorph DNA with other creatures in hopes of making an obedient killing machine. Now, their ultimate goal was to develop a queen that would give them control of other xenomorphs. Now, this creature proved to be extremely ferocious and aggressive towards the natural xenomorphs, and would even go on to battle the queen herself. Now, at one point, Professor Kleist even tested this creature by seeing if it would kill a human that posed no threat. It didn't attack, but it did attack the other xenomorphs placed in the same cell. Now, even though the Alien King was larger and stronger, the queen had superior speed and intellect that gave her the chance to dodge the king's brutish attacks. During this battle, it was even shown that this rogue alien did not care for any xenomorph, as it even crushed the queen's eggs while the queen herself carefully avoided them. Even the mighty Praetorians were crushed by the Alien King, as their corpses were found later on. Now the queen eventually wore it down and finally slaughtered it. Now, this is another case of a very unique type of alien that didn't last too long in the story. Even though it was genetically engineered by humans, it proved to be much more dangerous than a normal xenomorph because it could not be controlled by any outside force. Now, this is an idea that's never been brought to a movie or video game. Now, the comic books tend to have a vast amount of alien types that are very unique and some that are very odd. But what do you guys think? Would you like to see an Alien King in a movie or video game? Put your comments down below. What's up everyone, Acidglow here, back with another video around the Aliens universe. So the Bull Alien was featured in the Alien Space Marines mini comic book series from the Kenner Toys based on the Aliens franchise. It was seen in the issue called Aliens Stampede. Now they were seen to travel in herds and didn't seem to require any cover or low lighting to attack. They were so aggressive that they attacked the Marines in broad daylight in an open field. Now, it takes various traits from the bull host with a large body running on four limbs, massive horns, and a reddish body color. Some new features brought on by the xenomorph DNA is an extra armored body that is resistant to bullets and even explosives, but it was shown that only the flamethrower was the efficient weapon against it. Now, the xenomorph can also use its head to ram up against other life forms and even other vehicles. This creature is also known to run extremely fast, and combining that with its aggressive nature and fully armored body, it makes it a very dangerous xenomorph to encounter if you're not well prepared. Now, this variant of the xenomorph only made an appearance in the comic book, but its design was also used for a future alien, such as the Crusher, that was seen in the video game Aliens Colonial Marines. Welcome back everyone, Acidglow here. So I'm back with another video surrounding the Alien universe. In this video, I'll be talking about the Facehugger and the Royal Queen Facehugger. I thought I would include them both into one video, so you can see the differences between them, even though they have slightly similar roles. So the normal Facehugger has soft, light-colored skin, a tail, and eight legs. It wraps its legs around the host's head, and the tail slides around their neck, which makes the host gasp for oxygen. This is when the parasite inserts a tube down their throat. During this process, the facehugger provides oxygen to the host to keep them alive, while the alien embryo is slowly pushed down the throat of the host. This process can take several hours, and some attempts to remove the facehugger from a host have proven to be fatal. Some causes of death can result in suffocation, skin tearing, or even extreme burns from their highly acidic blood. A normal facehugger will die after it impregnates a single host, as it can only carry one embryo. Their legs and tail allow them to quickly traverse areas, and their small size makes them difficult to target. They are known to rely more on stealth techniques when looking for a suitable host. Now this brings us to the Royal Queen Facehugger. It is a slightly different version of a normal facehugger. Its physical traits include a darker tone of their skin, a bladed tail, an armored body which gives them better defense, and its legs are attached by a webbed layer of skin. It is capable of laying more than one embryo before dying. The first embryo is normally going to spawn a drone xenomorph, and the second embryo is most likely going to be the queen. This way, a full-grown alien is around to protect the incoming queen if a suitable host is found. Now, in Alien 3, the assembly cut version of the film, it does show an inmate finding the facehugger that impregnated an animal along with Ripley. As you can see, it has webbed legs. Since only one alien egg was shown in the start of the movie, it is believed that this one facehugger was in fact a royal queen facehugger that impregnated two hosts before dying. Now, some sources say that in the event that a royal queen facehugger is not present, an ordinary facehugger may grow the ability to implant a queen embryo inside a host. Now, the video game Alien vs. Predator Extinction did feature a Praetorian facehugger. Also, in another video game called Alien 3 The Gun, you will see a super facehugger, which one can assume is the same as a royal queen facehugger, but under a different name. Now, it was also listed to make an appearance in the arcade shooter Aliens Armageddon and the novel Alien Sea of Sorrows. So, what do you think of the royal queen facehugger? Is it something you want brought back, or do you think they should stick to the normal facehugger in the future? Put your thoughts in the comment section. If you enjoyed this video, then subscribe to the channel to see more content surrounding the Alien and Predator universe. My name is Asaglow, I'll see you in the next video. The gorilla alien is a massive brute of the xenomorph strain. They have extra long arms, which were inherited from the gorilla host, that are used to hold a victim in place. Now, their skulls are also enlarged and believed to store acid that is used to spit on a victim once the gorilla alien holds them down. Their highly acidic spit is suggested to come out of their inner jaw. They are known to run on their knuckles, as other primates do. Now, it was part of the Kenner products for their Aliens toy line, and NECA also released their own version of the gorilla alien for their product line, although the two look very different from each other. They were mentioned in the Aliens Space Marines comic books of issue number 4 called Jungle Attack. The story mentions the Space Marines encounter the gorilla-like creatures with four arms while settling down on the planet Zeevan. They are running in their direction until they ended up running past the Marines, only because there was a greater threat behind them. Their dropship is then later destroyed when an alien spits acid on the warhead and it blows up the ship. The team is then stranded and forced to defend against this new threat. Now, during this battle, Ripley is captured by a gorilla alien and taken to the treetop hive. The Marines then plan a rescue mission, as a rescue ship awaits for them. Now, the gorilla alien was featured in the video game Alien vs. Predator on the Super Nintendo, and it appeared as a boss. It was also seen in the game called Aliens Infestation as a minor enemy and also as a boss. Now, for myself, I like seeing new types of aliens to change things around a bit. But what do you think about the gorilla alien? Put your thoughts in the comment section. If you enjoyed this video, then subscribe to see more content around the Alien and Predator universe. Thanks for watching. My name is Asaglow, and I'll see you in the next video. The Engineers are an ancient, extraterrestrial species of unknown origin. They possess highly advanced technology and have special interests in genetic engineering. They are believed to travel entire galaxies with the purpose of creating life and even destroying life. Even though they are seen as gods, they are shown to be mortal beings that can still be injured and die. Now, early stories show they're even willing to sacrifice their own people in an attempt in spreading their DNA across a planet to create microorganisms. Although the name Engineer is not their official name, it was given to them by Elizabeth Shaw in the movie Prometheus because of their ability to engineer and create life forms. Now, other names given to them are Pilots, Space Jockey, Oceans, or Malakok. Even though they are extraterrestrials, they are known to still require oxygen to breathe like humans. They were shown to have extreme amounts of physical strength, as it sent Mr. Whalen's security team flying across the room. Their biosuit seems to act like body armor, as it was shown to be very resilient to firearms. Now, over time, they saw humans evolve through their culture and technology. The engineers noticed the human race has become violent, hateful, and dangerous at times. At some point, the engineers thought of giving the humans one last chance to change their ways. They decided to send down one of their people in hopes of putting the humans back on track. They wanted the humans to live in peace without waging war against each other. They saw humans as misbehaving children. The person they sent down was their version of Jesus or some type of religious emissary. This person brought the message of peace. Some humans rejected this message and crucified him. This act angered the engineers and led to their decision to wipe out the human race. The engineers intended to transport the black goo to Earth, but before they could do that, the weapon cargo escapes and an outbreak occurs on their ship. Many engineers died, but one of them survived and put himself into hypersleep. The weapon cargo is known to include the black goo accelerant and also xenomorph eggs that are held in stasis beneath a blue electrical mist. Now, in the distant future, around 2,000 years later, humans aboard the ship Prometheus located this moon and found the surviving engineer, along with some deceased ones. Through some DNA testing, they found their genetic makeup predates the humans and are the same, meaning the engineers created the humans. This then leads to Mr. Wayland, along with David and his security team, awakening the last surviving engineer. Upon waking up, the engineer sees the humans have evolved their technology way past their expectations. The engineer was in awe, as the humans were even able to create something like David, an android. The engineer noticed that the humans are still visibly violent and dangerous, as he chose to attack them and try to continue his original mission, which was go to Earth and wipe out the human race. Now, this information was even backed up by Ridley Scott when he said at one point, the script of Prometheus explicitly spelled this scenario out. Ridley Scott said that was the direction they were taking the story, but only at some point. Now, one theory about this scenario is that humans are seen as failed experiments. Their violent and uncontrollable nature proved to be too dangerous. Our actions alone could have depicted our fate by a higher power unknown to us. We are then seen as disappointments or mistakes in the eyes of the engineers. Now, another theory is that the engineers did not want humans to evolve as much as they had to have the ability to travel to distant planets. If humans were able to acquire the technology from the engineers, they would be even more dangerous to their own race and others. So in an attempt of protecting the human race from their own dangerous nature, they were to be wiped out, which eventually did not happen. Now, the engineers were not always depicted to be this way. A novel by Alan Dean Foster, based off the Alien movie in 1979, had the engineers appear physically different, and their personality traits were also different. They were described as being noble people that hoped in meeting mankind under pleasant circumstances. So why do you think the engineers wanted to wipe out the human race? If you agree with any of these theories or want to include your own, put it in the comment section. If you enjoyed this video, then subscribe to the channel to see more future videos around the Alien and Predator universe. Thanks for watching. My name is Acid Glow, and I'll see you in the next video. What's up everyone, Acid Glow here, back with another video around the Alien universe. The Mantis Alien is a creature brought up in the Kenner toys from the 1990s. It also had its own small comic strip inside each packaging of the toy. It was seen in issue number 10 called Aliens Swarm. Now, the original design was green and had insect-like characters. Now, it was lacking its normal claws, but instead had arms with three pincer-like digits with large talons. The underside of their arms were also seen to have spikes. The comic book is shown to display them as very agile xenomorphs that can jump great distances. Now, NECA even released their own version of the Mantis Alien while still paying homage to the original from the Kenner products. So the story around the Mantis Alien is that they were attacking a colony that was preparing to evacuate aboard a shuttle. But Ripley discovers the shuttle is infested with Queen Facehuggers and that have captured all the colonists. The Mantis Alien was even able to make a 90-foot jump with ease thanks to the powerful legs. A battle then takes place for a short while until the Mantis Aliens are all killed off. Now, there isn't much else known about this xenomorph type. It's kind of hard to picture a large mantis that a facehugger could attach itself to. But then again, these are the comic books, so anything is possible. Now, there was an assumption that this creature could have been made by the Weyland-Yutani Corporation through DNA manipulation. Now, considering the fascination that the Weyland-Yutani Corporation has with this creature, it's possible they could have been involved with this kind of testing. However, there is no direct evidence to prove this theory. So, what do you think about the Mantis Alien? Do you think it's a viable replacement for the standard xenomorph, or do you think its design is a little bit too far-fetched? Put your thoughts in the comment section. The Alien Queen Mother. They are the supreme rulers of the xenomorph nest. Even the alien queens and the empress will take orders from them. Now, the Alien Queen Mother is protected by enlarged elite drones known as Palatines. These Imperial Guards are only known to be on the xenomorph homeworld, and are always protecting the Queen Mother's royal chamber. The Queen Mother's nest consists of 6 orbs arranged around a central orb where they will all reside. Now, if a Queen Mother dies, a drone can molt into a Queen Mother by using the royal jelly. Thus, this would guarantee a Queen Mother can always be present to rule the Xenomorph Hive. Now, Queen Mothers possess telepathic and empathic abilities, which allows them to reach their hive over a great distance. There was an occasion where one was capable of melting into the minds of humans during the infestation of Earth. Like the lesser queens, the Queen Mother is capable of laying eggs. Now, in the comics, the Queen Mother was even shown to display a great deal of intelligence when her last egg was threatened. A Queen Mother was seen during the comic series of The Deadliest Species, where she was so old it was no longer capable of reproducing. She ended up getting captured by the white hybrids. She is then impregnated by a hybrid's facehugger, but before she dies, she was able to grab hold of the white hybrid king and hold him as her chest bursted, which killed them both. So what do you guys think about the Queen Mother? Would you like to see her in a future movie or video game? Put your comments down below. If you enjoyed this video, then click that like button and please consider subscribing for more videos on the Alien and Predator universe. The Xenomorph T-Rex hybrid is something so outrageous and scary, it can be quite the competitor against other creatures like the Queen Mother and the rogue alien king. This massive creature seems more dangerous than a normal Tyrannosaurus Rex, and it's possible it would have dominated the dinosaur era. This hybrid seems to keep the body of the T-Rex host, although while its arms still remain the same, it is shown to have a massive crown and spikes that protrude near the back of the neck and tail. This would prove to be useful in defense. It is shown to have an inner jaw, which would cause more damage if its prey were captured by its massive jaws. This hybrid also seems to take on the Xenomorph exoskeleton, which can provide slightly better armor compared to the standard T-Rex, which was a fleshy dinosaur. Another interesting detail about this creature is its massive bladed tail, which could probably cause considerable damage, if not instant death, to another creature. Not much else is known about the creature, like its reproductive abilities, and if it would roam with other xenomorphs, or if it's strictly a lone predator like the original T-Rex. This terrifying creature has never been seen in a comic book, novel, video game, or movie, but it's certainly a creature that would bring fear to a lot of victims it may encounter. This creature was drawn by the artist Stefan Sejic, and then a 3D model was developed by Oliver Pabellona. I wanted to cover this creature because I found it really interesting, and the design was so well done. Now, one could assume there's no facehugger big enough to attach itself to a fully grown T-Rex dinosaur. So if a creature like this was to be created, then a facehugger would have to impregnate a young T-Rex. And from there, I believe that Xenomorph would grow into this massive, terrifying hybrid, the Xenomorph T-Rex. One can only imagine how dominating a creature like this would be back in the dinosaur era. Now, since the comic books around the Alien universe have given us Xenomorphs based off other creatures, I was curious what you thought about this hybrid. Since we can have hybrids off humans, predators, or other animals, then why not a hybrid off a dinosaur? Well, put your thoughts about this creature in the comment section. If you enjoyed this video, then subscribe to see more topics around the Alien and Predator universe. Thanks for watching. My name is Acidglow, and I'll see you in the next video. The Crusher Alien. Introduced in the video game Aliens Colonial Marines during the events on LV-426. It is also known as the Smasher, the Charger, or the Xeno Crusher. This new species of alien proved to be extremely powerful and heavily armored to bullets. It shares a massive crown, similar to what is seen on the Praetorian, except the Crusher tends to have a larger mass of muscle beneath its exoskeleton. Now, the Crusher alien seems to have some command over other aliens within its vicinity. Normally, aliens of this size are to remain protecting the hive, but the Crusher seems to have a different role. It is seen running on all fours and using its size and armored body to its advantage. The Crusher prefers to use a more aggressive approach in combat. It charges forward while deflecting incoming bullets, trying to smash its target with its massive head. During this attack phase, the Crusher runs blind, as it lowers its head to make use of its fully armored crown. Now, this species of alien is very new, and it is believed it was a young queen, or possibly a Praetorian, that was infected by nuclear radiation, and during its molting phase, it turned into the Crusher. Now, the radiation poisoning was due to the explosion that occurred at the end of the movie Aliens. It's possible this radiation infected other aliens and molted them into new types, which are seen in the video game Aliens Colonial Marines. Now, although its head is heavily armored and resistant to most firearms, the rest of its body is still armored but will eventually wear down from constant damage. Using explosives and fire on its body seem to be the most effective methods of killing this creature. Weapons like a flamethrower are efficient, as well as using the P9 Sonic Harpoon Rifle, which fires darts that dig into the target and explode. So what do you think of the Crusher alien? Would you like to see it return, or do you prefer the Praetorian version? Also, do you think this was a natural molting process, or do you accept the theory this was caused from radiation? Put your thoughts in the comment section. Welcome back everyone, Acidglow here, back with another video around the Aliens universe. So this time we'll be looking at the Flying Alien Queen, and also other versions of flying aliens that have been seen in other sources. So the Flying Queen alien was part of the Aliens toy line back in the 1990s by Kenner Products. It was seen in their mini comic book strips that came featured with the toy figures. Now it was seen carrying off their ATAX unit, but was later killed. The Flying Queen alien has a huge wingspan with a membrane-like layer of skin that gives her the ability to fly. Now, some versions of the Flying Queen alien were seen to have the same features from the wing, but on the tail. Now, the one in the comic book was also seen to have spikes coming out of her head. Now, there were flying aliens featured in the Aliens arcade game that came out in 1990. Now, the arcade shooter, Aliens Armageddon from 2014, also featured flying aliens, but it also had a Flying Queen alien that's seen to pick up an armored vehicle as she throws it away. This gives the indication that her legs are more developed than a normal queen alien. Now, the 2006 arcade game, Aliens Extermination, had a flying alien dragon and also flying chestbursters. There was also another flying alien boss in the Super Nintendo game, Alien vs. Predator. So the idea of flying aliens has been used quite a bit. Now, it is believed the Flying Queen alien was a result of genetic mutation and created by the Weyland-Yutani Corporation, seeing as how they've had a long history of wanting to use the xenomorph species as a bioweapon. Now, the Flying Queen alien also has the ability to lay eggs that carry flying facehuggers. Now, it seems like the video games and the comic books are more willing to explore different types of aliens that are more obscure and possibly not through a natural process. Could you imagine a Flying Queen alien chasing Ripley? I think it would be much harder to deal with. So what do you think of the idea of flying aliens in general? Do you think they should expand on this idea, or should they stick to the original design? Put your thoughts in the comment section. Welcome back everyone. So in this video I'll be talking about two important things in Alien Resurrection. So the first part is the explanation of the newborn alien. Now this all starts back at the end of Alien 3. Where Ripley had an alien queen inside her. Now, even though she died, scientists were still able to take samples of her blood found on Fiorina Fury 161 and clone her. Now, after multiple failed attempts of cloning Ripley properly, they finally managed to successfully clone her with the alien queen still inside her. So the alien queen was surgically removed from her body. Now, this alien queen matured normally into laying eggs, but later on, she entered another phase where she developed a womb. This was inherited from the DNA exchange from Ripley. This then led to the queen giving birth to the newborn alien. Now, the newborn shared genetic material from both the xenomorphs and humans. Although it looked more alien-like, it had some human features like eyes, a tongue, a nose with a sense of smell, and a noticeable display of emotion. It also had softer, white-colored skin, and what looked like female genitalia. Now, it lacked the dorsal tubes on their back, but it had red blood, but it is unknown how acidic the newborn's blood is. It seemed to possess incredible strength as it killed a defenseless queen in one hit. Now, this brings me to my next topic. Why didn't any xenomorphs attack the newborn after it killed the queen? Now, it's well known the alien queen can communicate and control her warriors, as it was shown in Aliens. This was also displayed in Aliens vs. Predator when the Queen ordered her warriors to set her free. Now, we know some aliens were close to the Queen after they dropped Ripley there. Now, even though the Queen died very quickly, there probably was no time to save her. But why didn't the remaining aliens mount a last attack on something that could possibly kill them? Now, one theory is that the aliens accepted the newborn becoming the new leader of the Hive. Perhaps the remaining aliens could sense this new creature was very strong, so they preferred to keep their distance from this creature. Now, there's no visible sign if the newborn could communicate or control the rest of the aliens, so it's hard to say how the two species would have interacted if placed in close proximity of each other. The newborn was eventually killed by Ripley 8, when she cut her hand on the creature's teeth, then using her own acidic blood to create a hole in a window behind the creature. As a hole formed, the vacuum effect from space sucked the newborn through it and it was crushed into tiny pieces. The Grid Alien was featured in the 2004 movie Alien vs. Predator. It was born from a human host in a pyramid located on Bouvetoy Island in Antarctica. During a scene when the Celtic Predator was occupied with Sebastian and Max, the Chopper Predator focused on Lex. He kicks her to a wall and is about to kill her with a scimitar, but Grid intervenes and stabs him in the back with its tail. It lifts its massive predator, then it kills it with its inner jaw. Chopper dies, and then Celtic steps up to challenge this alien. Grid leaps from above and lands on him. They wrestle on the floor, with each one trying to gain the advantage. Celtic eventually kicks Grid away from him. This alien then knocks the predator off its feet, then tries to stab it with its tail, but misses. The predator then cuts its tail off with its wrist blades, and then tackles the alien and throws it away. Grid gets up and throws acid from its tail, which starts to melt Celtic's armor away, so he's forced to remove it. Grid then tries to jump this predator from above, but is tied up in a net, and it smashes through the floor. As the predator gets closer, the alien's acid blood breaks the net, and Grid jumps on Celtic and kills him right away with its inner jaw. It is from this battle that its name was given from the injuries it suffered by the predator's net weapon. This alien was later seen to capture Sebastian, who was taken to the Hive to be impregnated. Grid then located Lex and Scar, but it stayed back as it watched other aliens die by the predator's shoulder cannon. Then the queen alien is heard in the distance and calls for her aliens to help her. The aliens free her by damaging her body, so the acid splashes on its chains. They melt away and the queen escapes. Now, the last sighting of the Grid alien was near the end of the film. One alien before it was killed by Lex. Then, as Grid jumped towards Scar and Lex, they both escape, and Grid died from the explosion that was from the Predator's self-destruct device. The Grid alien was seen to be more intelligent and cunning than the other aliens in the movie. It didn't always rely on its natural killing instinct, as it sometimes chose to approach situations in a different manner. It made decisions like surprising its victim and deciding when to not engage in combat. Now, a version of the Grid alien was seen in the 2010 video game Alien vs. Predator, but it went under the name of Nethead. So, that covers the story of the Grid alien in the first Alien vs. Predator movie in 2004. Was it your favorite alien from the films, or do you prefer another one? Put your thoughts in the comments section. The Xenoborg character was featured in the 1999 video game Aliens vs. Predator, a product created by the Weyland-Yutani Corporation from their desire to weaponize the Xenomorph species. This cyborg was equipped with 3 laser-targeting devices and 2 large laser guns. It was meant to be used as an automated defense weapon. Now, upon encountering this machine, it will activate and begin scanning the area for targets. It moves very slow, but is armored on some areas of its body. It is known to be very resistant to explosives. Weyland-Yutani attempted to create a new form of the Super Soldier, but this was the end result. In doing so, the Xenomorph lost all of its natural instincts and abilities. Although it is a fusion of organic and mechanic materials, it mostly just functions as an automated weapon while appearing to look like a Xenomorph in some aspects. Now, despite being armored and having incredible firepower, it does have some weaknesses. Its activation sequence is rather slow, and because of the numerous amount of armor plating on its body, its traveling speed is the slowest in the game. You are able to destroy the guns on each arm, but it will still function. Now, by shooting its legs off, you can kill the cyborg. But one of the quickest ways to dispatch this enemy is to shoot the green light on its head. Some weapons might only temporarily disable the Xenoborg, but it will reboot its weapon system unless it is destroyed. Now, they still retain the properties of their acidic blood, so close-range combat is still dangerous. Although these cyborgs are extremely slow, their tough armor and high-powered laser guns can even be troublesome for a hunter in melee combat, which is why long-range weapons are the better choice. The smart disc seems to be very useful when dispatching these enemies. So the Xenoborg was encountered by the Marine and the Predator during their campaigns. Some websites have listed a Xenoborg to appear in the video game Aliens vs. Predator 2 from 2001, but the scene this was referenced was just an injured alien with no cybernetic parts on its body. Now the Xenoborg was listed to make a brief appearance in the comic books. So what do you think about the Xenoborg? Do you like the idea, or do you think it doesn't fit at all? Put your thoughts in the comment section. The Raven Xenomorph was featured in the video game Aliens Colonial Marines. This alien type is a strange and very rare breed that was encountered by Colonial Marines from the USS Zephyr ship. This new alien type was lurking in the sewers below Hadley's Hope on LV-426, the location previously explored by the Marines in the Aliens movie. The Raven is somewhat similar to a normal Xenomorph, but with a few differences. It walks on its two legs and is almost never seen walking on all fours. Its exoskeleton is more resilient than a normal alien's. It is bulletproof, and its tail has a row of spines, while the tail itself has a harpoon look to it. Now, its facial features are quite disturbing, as it appears to have eye sockets, a nasal cavity, jaws, and teeth that are blunt and human-like in appearance. Its face seems to be scarred, and the top of its head has a line of spikes. The Raven appears to be taller than a normal Xenomorph, possibly being equal height to a Praetorian. It can also emit a terrifying loud roar, which can be heard across long distances. This is very different from a normal alien that is known to have a hiss or screeching sound, and on some rare occasions, they can be heard snarling. It's possible they may have some leadership among smaller aliens. This creature is seen to be extremely aggressive. It may also attack other Xenomorphs. It will attack and capture anything to cocoon them later on in order to breed more future aliens in the hive. Its aggressive and reckless nature may be a side effect from some sort of mutation. It's possible this creature mutated from radiation effects due to the nuclear explosion that occurred in Aliens. The creature was eventually killed by Corporal Winter with the use of a power loader. Now, I actually like this part of the game. Being chased by that creature and trying to escape was a lot of fun. So what do you think about the Raven alien? Do you think it's a suitable replacement for a Praetorian? Which one do you prefer? Put your thoughts in the comment section. Hudson was a private with the Colonial Marines on the Sulaco ship that was deployed to Hadley's Hope on LV-426. His team was sent in to investigate the sudden loss of communications with the colonists. He was a skilled combat technician, part of the 2nd Battalion Bravo Team. During his mission on LV-426, the team encountered the Xenomorphs and most of their team was killed off. The remaining survivors had to retreat and they escaped alive, but with very little options of leaving the planet. As Bishop volunteered to realign communications with the Sulaco, the rest of the team decided to defend incoming aliens from within. All known exits are sealed off, but the aliens manage to find a way inside and a fierce battle ensues. Burke leaves the team stranded by locking the door, which was a means of escape, while Hudson bravely fights off the seemingly endless swarm. Just then, an alien comes up from below him and pulls him down. Hudson tried to shoot the alien, and Hicks even tried to save him, but it was too late. Hudson was gone. It's at this point where we don't know how Hudson died. After the movie Aliens ended, this story was continued in the video game Aliens Colonial Marines. Marines were then sent in on the USS Zephyr ship to see what happened on the planet. During the mission called Raven, the player is chased by the Raven alien, and in the sewers of Hadley's Hope along the way, you can find a Marine that's been cocooned on the wall. You can also see this Marine die from a chestburster. This Marine's face looks very similar to Hudson. Even the dialogue during this part says, "That's a Marine. Must have been from the Sulaco." Now, do you agree with this depiction of Hudson's death in Aliens Colonial Marines, or did you think back then he originally got killed by an alien after he got pulled down? Put your thoughts in the comment section. Our story begins on the planet BG-386, where the Weyland-Yutani Corporation located a Predator pyramid and built a research facility above it. Now, as Mr. Weyland unlocks the door to this ancient pyramid, it releases an EMP blast that shuts down all their equipment, and in the process, it sends a signal into space to other Predators. We are then taken to a room within the research facility, with human hosts giving birth to chestbursters. All the chestbursters come out as normal, except one of them. This last one chooses to exit through the host's mouth. Now, as Dr. Groves tries to gas the creature, Mr. Whalen stops him and requests to take the specimen alive. There is something special about this specific alien. Now, each alien is branded a number during research, and this alien is number 6, also known as Specimen 6. Now, the xenomorphs grow and are studied over time by Dr. Groves and his team. He is impressed with the qualities the xenomorph species has. He admires them for being a xenobiological marvel. Six then hears the matriarch scream and tries to escape, but is gassed and locked up again. And this is when the events of Mr. Whalen's exploration of the Predator Pyramid occur. The EMP blast knocks out all electronic equipment in the facility, and all the xenomorphs are set free and start to kill the humans. Dr. Groves escapes right before Six kills off his science team. Six is able to destroy a working computer that still has the matriarch chained up. She is set free, and the aliens, along with the matriarch, escape the facility and start a hive in the lower levels of the refinery. At this point in the story, Marines are sent to BG-386 in an attempt of controlling the alien outbreak. As a group arrives in the refinery, they are attacked by xenomorphs, and the remaining survivors flee to the basement. Six runs through the refinery to eliminate the humans that are invading the hive. Along the way, many Marines are killed, and a few civilians are taken as hosts for future xenomorphs. As Six leaves the refinery, it's then located in the jungle, where more Marines are encountered and eventually killed off. When Six arrives at the gateway facility, the Marines try to capture her, but Six proves to be an intelligent xenomorph and uses an explosive to create an exit. These remaining Marines are killed off, and Six proceeds to the ruins. The ruins is now being protected by armed synthetics. Some researchers are examining this area, and Six gets the upper hand and kills them off. Any remaining civilians are held down and impregnated by facehuggers. With Six being an intelligent and lethal xenomorph, the hive is slowly expanding its numbers and spreading its control on the planet. After activating 3 plates, a door is unlocked, which leads to a combat arena. It is here where Six meets 2 predators and fights them at the same time. The 2 hunters prove to be skilled warriors. Now Six is accompanied by 1 other alien, which aids her in the battle. The 2 predators are killed off, but the fight is not over. An elite predator appears from atop and jumps down to challenge Six. This battle lasts quite some time, and both of them suffer minor damage. As the battle nears its end, Six tries to grab the predator, only to get thrown down. It seems this is the end for Six, and this is where the xenomorph story might end. The elite predator pulls out its wrist blade and is about to deal the killing blow, but then Six reacts quickly and impales his chest with the tail. This attack is fatal on a predator, and it falls back in pain. Unable to fight back, as Six removes its mask, a facehugger impregnates the elite hunter, which later gives birth to a pred alien. Now, after this battle, as Six tries to return to the hive located in the refinery, the screams of the matriarch are heard. A lone Marine made its way into the hive and set off explosives. As the matriarch slowly burns away and dies, Six is captured by combat synthetics. Six is then taken aboard a ship and brought to a space station near the planet. It's then revealed that not all went according to plan for the humans here. Six managed to escape here, and again killed off everyone. But deep within the lower levels of the space station, Six is seen resting and molting. Her old cast comes off, and Six is revealed to become the new queen of the hive. Mr. Wayland was right. There was something special about Specimen 6. So, what did you think about the story around Number 6 in the video game Alien vs. Predator from 2010? And if you played the video game, what did you think about that? Put your thoughts in the comment section. Hey, what's up everyone? It's Acid Glow here. So in this video here, I'm going to be discussing and explaining the alien acid spitter type. Now, it's also known as the Ranger. It is a xenomorph cast that was encountered by soldiers in the video game Aliens Colonial Marines that came out in 2013. Now, it attacks by spitting large quantities of acid at enemies, typically from a long distance away. Although this xenomorph type and design was playable in Aliens Colonial Marines, the idea of alien spitting acid was used in other video games in the past, and it was also seen using a variation of this attack in the movies Alien 3 and Alien Resurrection. Now, the spitter possesses a big head crest that's different from those seen on a Praetorian and Queen, but it's smaller and smoother. Now, the crest is also fitted with pouches that store acid fluid. The pouches are located mostly along the side, but it can vary depending on the different strain of the spitter type. Now, these pouches are very sensitive to damage, which also means if you puncture these pouches, it can be an effective way to eliminate a spitter. Now, just be sure to keep a distance away when you plan to rupture these pouches, as the explosion can result in a massive rain of acid in a close range. Now, when we look at its tail, it has an axe-like appearance, which is sometimes shared by the Praetorian type of alien, but the spitter alien prefers to use their acid-spitting ability in combat. Now, the body of the spitter tends to have a more bluish hue and color compared to other xenomorph types, and they have larger claws on their paws. Now, the spitter can be very effective when it works in coordination with other aliens, as its acid spit attack can be used to destroy barriers, floors, and weapons used by the colonial marines. And since the alien's exoskeleton was shown to be resistant to their own acid blood effects in the movie Aliens vs. Predator, it would be safe for other aliens to venture into areas that are sprayed with acid from the spitter alien. Now, in Aliens Colonial Marines, you were able to unlock different head skins for the spitter, and I thought they looked pretty cool. So, what do you guys think of the spitter alien type? Is it something you'd want to see brought back into a future movie or another video game? Put your comments down below, and thanks for watching. Corporal Andrew Harrison was featured in the 2001 video game Aliens vs. Predator 2. He was part of the Colonial Marines that was sent to LV-1201 to investigate the loss of communications with a research facility. Harrison was also nicknamed Frosty because of his ability to remain calm and focused in dangerous situations. He was skilled at many classic marine weapons, along with knowledge of a power loader, exosuit, and hacking device. Upon landing on the planet, their dropship was damaged, and each group was assigned to different tasks like turning on the power, clearing the landing zone, and activating a beacon. As Harrison makes his way forward, he comes across an invisible creature that is killing some survivors. During this time, they were all attacked by multiple xenomorphs, and some marines died in the process. Now, one marine named Hall was captured and taken for incubation. Harrison volunteers to rescue her. He enters the hive alone and fights off many aliens, only to find Hall was killed, died from a chestburster. After this, they reach an area with sealed-off doors. Harrison volunteers again to assist. He makes it through while battling many runner and warrior aliens. He unlocks multiple doors, which allows their APC to advance forward. The Marines then reach the forward observation pods and meet up with the survivors along with the Iron Bears led by Rykov. Harrison is then sent to the control deck in an attempt to use a booster transmitter to communicate with the primary observation complex. He is then betrayed and taken as a prisoner. As he manages to escape, he comes across Dark Predator, who was also captured. He sets him free and continues on with his own escape plan. He is then contacted by Tomiko, who gets Harrison to pick up some data that proves our brother was killed and also information about illegal genetic research on convicts. Tomiko assists him in escaping and leads him to a communications facility that is infested with xenomorph warriors and Praetorians. Near the end of this area, he battles a heavy predator and defeats it. After making contact with the USS Verloc, he calls down a rescue dropship and flies to the location of his team that is heading into a xenomorph hive. It turns out that his team was given false information from the corporates and they are heading into a trap. When Harrison lands, he uses an exosuit to fight his way through the hive and many xenomorphs are killed. The exosuit is equipped with a rocket launcher, minigun, flamethrower, and a high-powered laser gun that consumes the energy of the exosuit. As he makes his way through the hive, he lands in the lower areas and the exosuit is damaged. He is forced to proceed without it and ends up in a room with a space jockey and a queen alien who is assisted by many xenomorphs. His team was previously here but was forced to evacuate. Harrison picks up any remaining weapons and ammunition to hold back the aliens as he awaits a dropship for rescue. He then kills off two more Praetorians and the dropship missiles are used on killing the queen. As Harrison escapes with his team, they head back to pick up Tomiko, but she advised him to not rescue her as a rupture in the reactor's fusion cells sets off a massive explosion and the facility is destroyed. As the USS Verloc ship leaves the planet, they request medical intercept, and in the distance behind them, a Predator ship is seen following them. So that was the story of Andrew Harrison from the video game Aliens vs. Predator 2. So what did you think about his story, and did you ever play the game? Put your thoughts in the comments section. The Pred Alien is a very unique type of alien. It is the result of a facehugger latching itself onto a predator and then giving birth to a Pred Alien chestbuster. Now, the Pred Alien has seen many different variations of it across different things like the comic books, video games, and movie adaptations. But no matter where you see it, there's always a striking feature about it that makes it look very different from a normal alien. Now, depending which source you choose to believe, the Pred Alien can eventually molt into a Pred Alien queen and take control of the hive if there is no original queen available. But other sources say the Pred Alien is just considered to be another member of the hive and is treated no different than a drone. Now, the Pred Alien has been seen in two different variations. The first one is the fleshy type that's been seen in the Aliens vs. Predator PC game in 1999 and the sequel in Aliens vs. Predator 2 in 2001. Now, in this version, you can see it does not have a usable inner jaw, which is a noticeable feature of the classic alien specimen. However, in 2010, a new Aliens vs. Predator game was released on multiple platforms, and in this version, they went back to using the hard-boned exoskeleton of the alien design. This version was also given the mandibles, the dreadlocks, and as well as the inner jaws. Now, here's where things get a little different. In 2003, the video game Aliens vs. Predator Extinction did include a Pred Alien Queen. According to the story of this game, it was created by Dr. Kadinsky through a method of bioengineering between predator and alien DNA. Now, a Pred Alien Queen is said to be a natural impossibility and was only obtained through genetic engineering. However, the movie Aliens vs. Predator Requiem contradicts this by featuring a juvenile Pred Alien Queen. Now, this Pred Alien was classified as a queen because it had the ability to create offspring. It would use its inner jaws to push its way down the host's throat, and from there it would implant multiple embryos inside the host, therefore increasing the rate of which more aliens would come out of this person as it died. Now, Pred Aliens are taller than both predators and human-spawned xenomorphs, and possess greater physical strength. The creatures are incredibly strong and fast in battle, combining the lightning-fast strikes typical of aliens with the brute force of the predator, making them deadly opponents to even elite predators. When it comes to their armor, it is more robust as it can withstand heat from magma and even shots from a plasma caster while receiving minimal damage. Now, in the 2010 video game Aliens vs. Predator, that Pred Alien did not interact with other aliens. It was running loose, just killing whatever it wanted. But in the movie Aliens vs. Predator Requiem, that Pred Alien was seen to take control of the hive and command other aliens. Now, although the Pred Alien has been seen to rip off the heads of its victims, it is unclear if it really has a motive or if this is just a natural result of memories passed down by its predator host. Now, the Pred Alien is considered to be an abomination by the predators, and therefore it must be killed. Now, in the video game Aliens vs. Predator Evolution for mobile platforms, the Predator does kill the Pred Alien Queen in the story mode, however, it does take the skull of that creature as a trophy. But in the video game from 2010 called Aliens vs. Predator, the Predator in that story does not take the skull of the dead creature. So, if you made it this far into the video, we are done. That covers various topics within the alien universe for about 1 hour. That's a lot of lore to go over, and I hope you enjoyed the video. If you want to see more stuff like this, then subscribe to my channel and turn on notifications. Thanks for watching. My name is Acid Glow, and I'll see you in the next video.